Okay, hello to everyone. It is July 4th, 2016. It is Independence Day here in the US. So happy Independence Day to my fellow Americans, and happy July 4th in general to everyone else in the world. So we're gonna have some fun today. We're gonna play some Blitz Chess on ICC, the Internet Chess Club. I've been using this site for most of my streams because it seems to provide the best balance between being able to look at the chat and play some games against good competition too. So that's why I've been sticking to ICC lately. I was just observing a game between the legendary player Olegas versus Lunatic X GM, and it looks like Olegas lost, surprisingly. You don't see him lose too often in the 5-minute pool, particularly with white. He's incredibly difficult to beat with white. He has a really solid opening repertoire, starts with knight f3 on move one, but Grandmaster Lunatic X got the job done. Lunatic X is Peter Michalik from the Czech Republic. Not familiar with that player. Hello to everyone in the chat. What's up, Kieran? My Diametrical. Fred, Flublit, Kevin, Ricardo, Chris, Thomas, Anton, Max. Glad to see all you guys here. Yes, Canada Day was July 1st, right? So shout out to the Canadians as well. We can't forget our neighbors to the north. Friendly neighbors to the north. Yeah, let's try to see some tactical fireworks today. I agree with that, Johnny. I think if I can continue playing like I did in the previous stream, that would be excellent. So I'm going to play e4 as white. I'm on the e4 train at the moment. So until it throws me off, I'm going to keep playing that move in my streams. Hello, Gaute. He says, first live stream from Norway. Love your videos. Keep it up. Thank you, man. Appreciate it. How's it going, The Juice? How's it going, Matthias? Matthew, Without Contrast? Green Scenery? Igor? No, I'm not at the World Open. The World Open is going on right now in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I have some students playing there, but I am not playing myself. I'm actually getting ready to go to a camp in Tucson, Arizona in less than a week. I leave on Saturday. So I'll be out there teaching for a week in the desert. It's going to be 100 plus degrees Fahrenheit. I'm not looking forward to the weather, but it's a chess camp, so it's indoors at this really nice resort, actually, this golf and tennis resort right in the foothills in the mountains in Tucson. E4 is good for your health, says Kevin. You could be right about that. I do feel inspired. This is one thing I mentioned before, and by the way, I'm waiting for a game right now. I'm not intentionally trying to deprive you guys of chess. But one thing I have mentioned a lot lately is that if you're in a rut with your game, consider playing a different opening. Because oftentimes I think playing a new opening will give you a new perspective on things. You're kind of looking at the game with fresh eyes. And even if you don't know every little detail about the opening itself, it's going to force you to think on your own in the opening and just get out of your normal thought patterns, basically. So I've often had positive results correlated with picking up an opening and trying it out. So give it a shot if you're struggling at the moment. I'm in the 3-minute pool. I'm just waiting to be paired. My 3-minute rating is pretty good. When we left off last stream, what was it? 2475. I'm actually at my peak right now with 3-minute. I've never been higher than 2475 through about 1,100 games played. So maybe, just maybe, I don't want to jinx myself, but if I could get over 2500, that would hopefully provide the fireworks that you guys are craving on this July 4th. Max asks, is there any Independence Day openings? Unfortunately not. Yeah, America kind of missed the boat as far as major chess openings go. Europe gets most of the credit when it comes to that. We have no major chess openings named after places here in the US. We have like variations and stuff, like the Wilkes-Barre variation of the Joko piano, stuff like that. But no, we got to give credit where credit is due. The Europeans popularized chess, and much of the development of chess openings is due to European players and the associated cities and places where the openings were first played and the people who studied and played them. Kyle says, greetings from Indiana. First time watching you live. Cool. Glad you could make it, Kyle. Hey, Stainer. Stainer says, I took your advice and tried out a new opening. It did some magic and it was a lot of fun. Yeah, yeah, even if you mess up and lose, I mean, if you're in a rut, then chances are you're going to have problems anyways, so you might as well play something new, right? Okay, d4, what do I want to play? I'm going to play knight f6, maybe a Benko Gambit, but he's going to play a London. Okay, so we're just going to play in anti-London style, b6, put the bishop on b7, and go from there, proceed from there. You know, I kind of want to hunt down this bishop, but I suspect he'll play h3 right here. He does. A no-nonsense move order. Let's play d6. And then we're going to put the knight on c6. This is all standard so far. Plays an early queen e2. Okay, we'll go a6, maybe with an eye towards playing b5. And what to do now? Queen d7. Yeah, I think queen d7. I'm going to play rook e8, followed by bishop f8, maybe pawn g6, bishop g7. Sound good to everyone? Good. The pressure on a6 is annoying. Ooh, that's a weird-looking move. Queen back to d1. Not quite sure what the point of that is. Maybe they're trying to pop the queen out to b3. I don't know. I don't think that should greatly bother me. Yeah, let's just do this. If knight c4, I can play knight d7, and I'm just reinforcing this weak point. Granted, I have put myself in a pin on this diagonal leaning towards my queen on c7, so that's a little awkward. I might have to play knight a5 in the future to attack the queen and maybe open some lines. Maybe I'll play that right now, knight a5. Yeah, this looks okay. Just checking for tactics, but I think it's fine. So we've got the doubled a pawns, but maybe I can play down the b file. That queen presents a juicy target on b3, so maybe I can go rook ab8, move the bishop away at some point, and attack b2, assuming that white's queen will flee the b file. Yeah, so let's do this now. And flee they do. So c4, I don't think that leads to much at the moment. I think bishop g7 is probably the most consistent move here. Yeah, let's just continue with our plan of getting the bishop fianchettoed. They do attack the a6 pawn again. Probably queen b6 is called for right now, defending a6. Playing around with the idea of bishop c6 attacking the a4 pawn. That looks logical. He wants to maybe take on c5 or remove the bishop and try to get at d6, I think. I can't do this right now because this pawn does hang. Let's go here. I got to play a little bit faster. He's playing quick moves and pressuring me on the clock right now. Okay, now bishop a6, but still the issue with the pawn hanging. Okay, how about this? And then queen into b4. But a6 falls in that case. Doesn't it? Okay, change of direction. We're going to go e5. And then if d5, I'm going to put the knight on c5. That's the new plan. Yeah, this move seems okay. Blocks the bishop on h2. I wish I could even up the time a little bit, so keep thinking to winning. That would be nice. Hello to the 189 viewers who are stopping in the stream. Stopping by to watch, that is. Thank you for tuning in on this Monday, July 4th. Okay, so I get the knight to c5. This seems to help a lot. Attacking a4. I can't really grab that due to rook b1. Actually, I probably can grab that. I'm going to do it. Let's be greedy. Okay, he gets rook b1 in, but big deal. Queen a3. This knight on c5 is a beast. Controls the d3 square. I'm greedy, man. If you give me a pawn, I'm going to take it. Rest in peace to Viktor Korchnoi, who never turned down a pawn. Now I'm going to go rook b8 and then probably bishop back to a8 to try to swap rooks down the b file. I really like the fact that his bishop is out of play on h2. This is a good move, though, I think. But still, I'm going to do this. I know he can harass my rook, but my queen's coming over to c3. I don't see how he's going to trap my queen, per se. And that's most important to me right now. Okay, I've got some stuff in store for my opponent. I'm going to let him take on d6 because then I get knight takes e4 in, which is a really nifty move. Threatening the rook, also threatening knight to c3. So let's see if he wants to swap off with me. He's going to double. Okay. Let's play bishop f8. Let's just guard d6 now. a4 is quite loose, but I don't want to take it yet. I want to control this point. This seems to be the key to the position, if you will. I also have queen a2 in mind, I think is a move that could bother him. Queen a2. Yeah, let's do that now. So pinning his bishop on c2, maybe encouraging him to run away or something. Let's go here. I'm thinking bishop d8, just kick out that rook, eject it from that square. Let's go here. Repositioning a little bit. Yeah, he's doing a kingside demonstration, but I'm not really that concerned. He doesn't have a lot of pieces in the vicinity. I do have to watch queen g4, though. Queen g4 is an irritating move. Ah, now rook b8. No, my position. My beautiful position. I'm going to lose some stuff now. Okay, check. Boy. My beautiful position is crashing down. Yeah, I think I'm just getting mated here. I guess I'll try to run away for the moment, but I'm getting mated in a few moves. Oh, what happened there? Queen g4, I underestimated that move. He came in with the queen and they hit the rook on, what was it, c8? Maybe I should have played h5. I should have shut down his counterplay on the queen side. h5, stopped the queen from coming to g4. Because I was in control on the queen side. If I would have just maybe played one tempo move on the king side, expended one tempo, h5, and stopped him, I think I would have had a good position. Yeah, my trouble started with this knight maneuver. Knight d7 to b6, that didn't accomplish anything. I should have just thought prophylactically here. h5. Ah, man, that was rough. Yeah, the kingside demonstration broke through. So, bummer. No, the Dutch is not in my repertoire. It is not. John, what do you recommend to play for black if white plays? Sorry, that question went out of there quite quick. Thank you, Samil, for turning in, for tuning up, tuning into the stream. I think the stream will go for about an hour, Craig. Okay, let's get back in there. I need revenge. I need revenge ASAP. My beautiful rating just took a tumble. I lost 24 points on that game. I gotta open a window too. One second. It's really stuffy in here. Alright. Apologies to any unnecessary outside noise that trickles in as a result of me opening that window. Hello, Omniverse. John, as black, do you play the Slav or the Semi-Slav? Asks Graphics. I play both. Yeah, both of those. Lately, Slav, but I played more Semi-Slav, I would say. Okay, Fire Tiger. This is a tough opponent, really quick player. He's going to play some Peart's Idea. Let's go with knight GE2. I'm going to play like a G3, bishop G2 type setup. And then try to go for F4 in the future. Get a big pawn roller. Maybe H3. H3 first just to secure a spot for the bishop on E3. And look to play F4 after that. Usually you wind up putting the knight on F3 in this line, but I think there is something to be said for doing it this way. Yeah, so now let's go F4. See how Mr. Tiger reacts. Okay, probably take with the knight in this case. But I guess he's playing knight c5 is his point. Maybe take with the queen. Even bishop is interesting. Let's take with the bishop. Then if knight c5... I thought I could play e5, but that's kind of nonsense, isn't it? I guess I could take on c5 and try to play that position. Give him double pawns. He will have the bishop pair, but yeah, maybe I can play that way. Okay, let's continue with g4. Let's do this. Now we're going to do this. Yeah, and we have a nice pawn wedge in the center, e5 and f4. Control of some key squares as well. It's not a position I'm too used to, but I like it. First sight, I like it. So he's offering to create more weaknesses. e6 would be nice, but I don't think that works tactically. Let's just take. He'll probably play knight takes now. So let's saddle him with some weak pawns. I'm thinking of f5, trying to keep his light square bishop at bay. But that weakens the dark squares. is the one thing about that move. So maybe it's better to play knight c3 and try to get the knight into e4. I don't know. But then he gets to go f5. I'm torn right now. Okay, let's just start with a flexible move. We're going to go here. If f5, I might take the pawn. This is my thinking. Okay, now I like f5 much more because the bishop can't easily reach this square. He could play c4, though. He probably should. c4, queen f3, bishop d6, something like that. Okay, but maybe I can go here. Stopping his bishop from coming to the d6 square even still. I can put the bishop in on e3. Maybe queen d6 in that case. Just trying to keep his development somewhat inhibited for the time being. Wants a queen trade. He's pretty persistent about that. Well, okay. I'll go for a queen trade, but you have to let me get my rook in the game. How about that? Bishop e3. Okay, so let's do like this. I want to win this pawn. That would be nice. So if bishop c5, I can't go rook to... Yeah, I can't do that. That would be nice if I could. Rook to f4, I mean. All right. He still has trouble getting the light square bishop out, so I'm sending this knight up, maybe to e4. Yeah, let's do that. Knight d6 check, always possible now. Also, g5 is an idea. I'm going to play g5. This is kind of aggressive, but knight d6 feels like settling. So I'm going to see if I can induce a trade on this square. And then if king g8, play f6 and get my pawn to f7 real quick. Like, Fire Tiger's fast, like I said, so let's keep the pressure on. Yeah, f6. I want rook d8, but it's not working yet. Let's play h4. Not quite sure about this move, but we'll find out if it's any good. using too much time. Okay, let's do this. Try to get a trade in. I still want to get my rook to d7 after the trade. That's my main line of thinking here. Okay, he's going to allow this to happen, huh? A little surprised by that. That doesn't seem like a good idea. Now g6 is coming very quickly. I think he kind of panicked right there. Yeah, this is really bad for black. These pawns are advancing on the same color as black's bishop. Should be pretty much losing for him. Now f7 is a big threat. I can even twist the knife. I think he's got to move his rook now. I can twist the knife further with this. G7 coming up. And he is not long for this world. Okay, let's go here. Let's go here. Take that pawn, first of all. Threatening rook e8 mate. Okay. Oh, I just ran out of time. One move from mate. Oh, I'm not quite fast enough right there. My lack of speed caught up with me. Yeah, I was in a winning position, but I think I finessed it too much. I brought my king up unnecessarily. Probably had much quicker ways to just end his resistance. Yeah, there was no reason to do this entire, like, king march. I should have just played rook h6 or something somewhere. All right, so that one kind of hurts. Hate to take a draw like that in a position where I was totally winning, but hey, it happens. John, do you play a game like League of Legends? No, I do not. Do not play League of Legends. Yeah, one move from mate. The chat is now reacting. It's hard to know. I was trying to get the roller checkmate. And the roller checkmate, by the way, is a really good motif to use in time pressure. You pretty much always want to go for that if it's available because you don't have to think. So I was just trying to set that up. All right, let's get back in there. Kippy, I played this player last time on the stream. So e4 move one once again. We'll play the advanced variation again. Bishop f5, h4. Why not? We'll take this for a spin, see how it goes. Play knight f3, we'll just play it normal. Bishop coming to d3 next. Okay, so he makes use of the d5 square. He's gonna take. And I think I'm gonna put the queen on e2. Seems a bit better than d3. I don't mind if he takes this dark square bishop. It's not a very good bishop anyways. Okay, now he's threatening to take and then play rook g3, so I have to be aware of that. Maybe bishop g5? Let's do that. So attack that queen on d8. Not sure about the Budapest Gambit. I don't have any experience in that one from the black side, but maybe I'll play it. Right, so I'm castling queenside. And my opponent plays a smart move, I think. I'm gonna take. You could take with a queen, probably, is good. Keep the d5 square blockaded. I'm gonna play king b1. I was just thinking he might have had an opportunity there to take on g5 and then try to win d4. Now I'm gonna attempt to reposition my knight. Okay, and he's staying solid, as he probably should. So if knight e4, he's gonna put his knight on f5, he's saying. But I think I should go for this anyways. I want to go f3 and g4 to kick him out. Let's play rook d3 first, though. I gotta play a little faster, I think. H4 hangs if that happens. I'm gonna let him take it, because I do have knight d6 if he takes it. So let's play like this. He can't take d4, that's important. Knight g5 is another move I'm thinking of. Once again, also knight c3 would kick him out for the time being. Let's do this. If queen here, probably queen e4. Although I am taking away a good square for my knight. He goes to that square instead. Okay, let's play queen e4, attacking this pawn. d5 would be really nice here. Can I get away with that? D5, pawn takes, knight takes. Yes, I think that works. And after all the cool trades occur, I can win f5. So, breakthrough idea. Also, if he takes several times, I might have rook takes d5. And he can't play queen e1 check, because my queen guards that square. So, that's looking good. He's got to be really careful here. This could be bad. If king b8, maybe knight b4. Threatening a devastating check on c6. Yeah. Just checking, checking, checking. Okay. He's got to take on d3 now, I think. But even still, he should be hard-pressed to defend. Okay, knight c6 check. Nah, I'm gonna do this. If queen b5, I think I can play a4. He's gonna do that. But now I can go here, right? Threatening mate, threatening the knight. And if the knight moves, knight c6 check just wins everything. That should be ball game. Yeah, I don't see a defense for black now. Queen b7 mate. Okay, so this was nice. We got a good position, I'd say, out of the opening. Well, not great, but I had a slight space advantage. The thing about this line, when you play the advanced variation, you do give up certain square control, like f5 and d5 tend to be in black's possession in the middle game. So when you put that pawn on e5. And he was making good use of that early on with the queen on d5 and the knight on f5. Maybe he could have played knight takes d4 somewhere. I don't know if it was ever feasible to do that, but I was thinking when I played rook d3, knight takes d4 is a possibility. I was going to play queen e3, and then if c5, I have knight takes c5, removing the defender. But our game picked up speed right here when I found this d5 breakthrough move. I think this is powerful. Black's got to be careful now. He might even be just losing or in big trouble. Let's check with the engine. Yeah, this is plus 4. Can you believe that? That's how strong the d5 idea is. One issue he faces, if I just go back there. Yeah, so black was fine, as you can see from the evaluation. But one of the major issues he faces is that if multiple trades happen on d5, like even if pawn takes here, I think I just play rook takes. I don't even have to go queen takes f5 and get the knight. I can play rook takes, threatening discoveries on his queen. And after this and this, I don't think there's anywhere he can go where he doesn't either lose the queen or get mated. Rook d7 followed by queen b7 mate is a big threat. This is plus 9. Arslan asks, was 28 knight c6 possible? Well, let me go back to the game and see. Yeah, so I thought about that move, but if I go knight c6, king here, and then take, he's taking on d1 with check, and he gets two rooks for the queen. I don't think I should allow this. King c2, although it's still tricky. Yeah, rook d5 is an important resource, blocking the queen from reaching c6. And now my queen and my knight are not coordinating as I would like them to. If queen c4, there's this, winning for black. So that's why I didn't play knight c6 check too early. I think if I just recapture and hold out, though, the threat of knight c6 is decisive. Or rook d7, plus 10. John play rival versus Simon Williams. Don't ignore, says Big KGG. I suspect Simon is traveling right now, or he seems like a pretty busy guy. I haven't seen him posting too many videos. But yeah, we've talked about it. We'll play it at some point. Not sure when I'll play Tall Baron. He just emailed me, so I gotta set up a time with him. As I mentioned, I am traveling in less than a week, so we'll see. Tony, the stream just started like 20 minutes ago or so. More than that, actually. Maybe 30 minutes ago. We've already been going a half hour. Okay, let's get back in there. I have an even score on the day, but I'm still down rating points. I'm playing okay, though. Deep strategy is next. We're going with, okay, the bishop f5, slow Slav. I don't mind this line for black. Lots of experience on the black side of this setup. I'm going to play the more dynamic stuff with bishop e4 and then back to g6. This is just a little more fun than bishop g6 right away. Everyone does the same thing in this line. They always play this setup without fail. Bishop d2, rook c1. Okay, this player castles instead. It's intriguing. So I want to take and then play b5. And I think I'm going to do it right now. He might take with the queen, but no, he does it this way. All right, so let's do this. And then we're going to play a6 and look to play c5. And operate on the queen side a little bit. He hasn't taken my bishop on g6 yet. I'm a little surprised about that, that he's delaying that decision. But it could make some sense. Okay, queen b7 or something else. e5 is interesting, although probably not best. Queen a5 also comes to mind. Let's do queen a5. Not a move you usually get to make, but I'm thinking if I get to go c4 and the queen has to move away, that a2 might be vulnerable after something like b4 kick the knight away. He takes. Okay, we'll take back. I'm not going to play c4 quite yet. Now I might play c4. We'll see. Yeah, let's do c4. Now I could play e5. I could also play a capture on d5, but e5 seems more normal and better. Or b4. But b4 he can take on e6, so I think I'm going to go with this one. Granted, my c4 pawn will be quite loose at the end of this line. I'm not thrilled about my minor pieces either. Okay, so he keeps pressing forward. He wants that d5 square for his knight, I think. It's his idea. Tick, take e7, take g3. Tick, 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 take e7 at the very end. Possible. Okay, let's try that. We'll see where this leads. Pre-move that capture, then I'm going to take that e7 pawn at the very end of this line. So I'm up a pawn, but my king is stuck in the middle. I got to watch the d5 square in particular, so I think I need to hurry with b4. He might want to play a3 for that reason. He's just going to do that. Okay. Let's play rook c8. I still want to go b4. But maybe I can defend my c4 pawn a little bit better. Knight b6 maybe? Nah, I'm going to do this. I know he can check and then get his rook in, but I'm hoping that I have good counterplay with stuff like queen g1 coming. Queen g1 is an idea. He might want to take on c4. I didn't have time to calculate this sequence, but I was just hoping that the queen coming to g1, maybe taking the pawn on g3 would be good for me. Again, we'll find out. Deep strategy, 24-10. I think he almost has to take on c4. I don't see another good move for him. So right now I'm just calculating what will happen if he does that. He does take. Queen c6. Queen c6 followed by knight c4 maybe. Knight b6 rather. Now let's give the check. I don't want to take that pawn. I'm worried about taking that pawn, so I'm going to do this. And then try to coordinate with like knight e5 coming. This is my main idea. Maybe I should just take now. Yeah, probably. You can play queen d6, but does that matter even? All right, I gotta do something. So my king's gonna be running is the thing. Queen d6 or that. He can't play rook h1, that's important. So I'm trying to get my king over to g8 now, is the whole plan. Let's hide the king, better do this. Let's go here. Oh, I'm way down on time. Gotta watch that time. Threatening f3 right now. Can he do that? Check, I guess he can. Yeah, I'm losing here. I can't run away with my king. That's too bad. Gotta resign. So I misplayed that one in the middle game somewhere. I think when I allowed the knight to d5, he is getting some play against my king in the center. Not quite sure I like this position. I wish I could play rook takes c4 here. That would be a nice move. Trying to deflect his queen away from guarding d1, but he just plays rook takes g1 in that case. And that backfires. So no good here. I'm up a pawn, but my king position is unstable. He might have good compensation for the pawn. Engine says I'm a little bit better, but that doesn't mean much. Yeah, and even right here, after rook takes d5, bishop takes c4, white is fine. I was worried if I took the pawn on g3 that he would play something like queen d2 or queen d3. Probably queen d2, attacking d7 and also b4, and I'd be feeling the heat. As I am literally in my room right now, it's really hot here. Okay, so this was all fine. He checked me, my king ran to g8. This position is objectively equal, but maybe easier to play for white. Yeah, and he can just play queen h2. Even though his king looks open, my king is more open when I can't run away for fear of losing the rook on c8. How's it going, Arab Assassin? Hey, Sidorite. I think this is Stockfish 7 that I'm using. if that's what you're referring to. The Chess Fundamentals series? Yeah, I do want to make some more episodes for that series. Hello, Ziff. Hi, John. Do you think solving exercises from a book with a board is more beneficial than from diagrams in the book? I think if you can solve directly from the diagrams, that's best. But if you have to use a physical board, that's fine too. I think the best thing to do is try to visualize as much as you can. And then once you have drawn some initial conclusions, then go and play out the position on the board if you haven't solved the problem already. I do like the two-pronged approach of using online tactics trainers like the chess.com tactics trainer, Lee Chess, Chess Tempo, those type of things, and also solving some positions just from a physical board. I think the 1-2 punch of that is good. Hello, Sarah. Hello, Arnold. Hello, James. Thanks, Rainbow Hot Pocket. We're up to 389 viewers. Fantastic. John, have you heard about Chessimo? I have, although I'm not familiar with it. John, did you ever find a video editor? No, I'm still looking into programs that I could use. I have almost no editing chops whatsoever. As you probably see by my videos, they're very bare bones. I just record the screen and do my thing. But I'm trying to get better at video editing. It's going to be a work in process. What do you think about Kevin Durant's move to the Warriors? Unexpected. I didn't think he would go to the Warriors. Yeah, I don't really know what to think about it. I mean, he wants to win a championship, so it makes sense. He wants to add to his legacy. Similar to LeBron going to the Heat several years ago. Yes, Padone, that's correct. That is my favorite book. Okay, Batman King is next. Let's stick with E4. Taking a rating hit this session, but I feel like I'm playing okay, maybe a little hesitant in certain spots. I'm gonna do another King's Indian attack against Batman King. Okay, this line. We just have to be careful against this line. Okay, I'm gonna play G3. But they can take on e4 is one annoying thing about this line. I'm gonna play e5 for that reason now. And we're gonna get this set up. Okay, let's play knight f1 as usual. He's gonna be rushing on the queen side. Let's play a3. I think that's a good move just to stop him for now. So he's using the delay castling for as long as possible strategy. Which is not bad, I think, in this line. You can do this. When he does castle short, he's going to be facing an attack on the king side, so can understand his motivation. Like now he'll probably play a light square bishop move, maybe bishop b7 or bishop a6. And he's challenging me to find a way through in the short term. Bishop f4 doesn't seem to add too much to my position. I could take on b4. That's interesting. I think I'm going to do that. Now that if he takes with the knight or the pawn, he loses a4, so he has to take with the queen. Okay, but now I think I can go here. I'm just playing purely to win the a pawn. This is an unexpected resource that cropped up, but I think it works. He's going to win my d pawn, he's claiming. Let's do this. This looks intriguing. Trying to open this long diagonal towards his rook on a8. And the knight on c6. Queen b3. Yeah, he does have some stuff that is annoying here. Okay, let's take this guy and look for the trade. Knight b6 makes sense. Let's put this here. I want at this guy. So if he takes on c4, I can move my knight away and hopefully attack that knight. See, now he might just want to castle, connect his rooks, and play down a pawn. But he'll have some compensation for it, I think. King d7, he's going to keep it in the center. Okay. Let's go b3. Just support c4. I want to play d4, but it's too risky at the moment. I'm going to keep d4 in my back pocket, though. If I ever want to break open the center, should be 7. Okay, we'll take that. Maybe now d4. Yeah, let's do it. It looks correct with this king on d7. Better than remaining passive, I think. Ah, did I miscalculate? Take, take, take. He has rook a1 at the very end. I think I miscalculated that. Misassessed it. Okay, so I think I gotta go here and try to win this pawn, basically. Without allowing the rook to into a1. Took some time off my clock to find that, though. Maybe I still have decent chances if d takes c4, knight takes d4. And I'm doing alright. Must play faster. D3, okay. Let's take. If rook a2, probably bishop d4. Though, actually, I'm gonna go here. See what we can do with that one. King runs away. Let's look for a swap. He can just trade everything down, though. Not sure about my last move. Maybe I merge up a pawn after all is said and done. I'm not sure. Okay, so let's take that. And then we're going to take this. And then we're going to go here. Try to get the dark square bishops off the board. Defend f2. If he takes here... Guess we'll just defend that pawn. Maybe knight e3 coming. Yeah, this should basically be equal, but we'll see what happens on the clock. Definitely an equalish endgame, but I'm down on time. Just trying to avoid some issues here. That was a bad move, I think, on my part. Guess we'll find out what happens. I gotta go passive now. This is not good. He can bring up his king. Yeah, he can make gradual improvements now. Let's go attack his rook. Stalemate? Oh! Yeah, I got stalemated at the end. I saw this stalemate trick. I actually might have been able to flag him if I didn't go for stalemate. But I'm happy with the stalemate, given that endgame I had. That's a funny one. Yeah, so king h1 right at the very end. And he was smart to take it, because if he doesn't, then I was just going to play rook g1 and he was going to lose. Topsy-turvy game. I won a pawn out of the opening, but it wasn't an easy pawn to hang on to, because my queenside was really fragile. And I've got a lot of my pieces massed on the kingside, but there was no kingside attack that ever materialized, because he never castled. So what's worth more, the pawn or the initiative? It's the age-old chess question, right? That was a fun game. Did you see the match between Komodo and Ehrenberg on chess.com? Any thoughts on human versus engine? I just saw the results. I think Ehrenberg got beat handily, even though there were handicaps in the games. I personally don't see the intrigue of human versus computer matchups anymore. It's just too lopsided. And there's something a little humiliating about top grandmasters having to receive odds, gigantic odds from engines just to be competitive. I know Magnus has said that he doesn't have any interest in human versus computer matchups. He's never played one of those matches himself, as far as I know. Can you play against Christoph? Chess Explained, who is streaming in a couple minutes. We'll see. I don't know what pool he plays. Probably 5 minute is what he's doing. What do you think about the Stonewall opening? It's a tough one to crack. So the Stonewall is for black, usually out of the Dutch. There's many move orders that can be used to reach it, but it's basically arranging your pawns on light squares like this. So you get this structure stretching from b7 all the way to f5. You have to watch your dark squares in this one. So like the black dark square bishop is a valuable piece. White often tries to exchange it off. Usually black will park it on d6 for the time being. So I'd say the Stonewall Dutch is better than its reputation. I think it has a slightly negative reputation, but it's a difficult opening to beat. I remember a game, didn't Magnus Carlsen beat Caruana in a nice game on the black side of a Stonewall? Very nice demonstration of that opening's potential. How do I become less nervous in chess games, especially in OTB tournaments? I think you just have to practice a lot. Yeah, if you play a lot OTB, you'll get over that nervousness. Thanks, The Juice. I'll try my best to make the GM title when I'm actually pursuing GM, that is. Right now, I'm not trying at all because I'm not playing any Grandmaster Norm tournaments, which is a shame. But I might make some plans to play some. I'm still debating. What do you think of the Sicilian with queen takes d4? So I think you mean this line, knight f3, and then after d4, the customary d4 taking with the queen. It's not bad. White gets a development lead in this, which is kind of funny because black can play knight c6 and attack the queen, but usually white plays bishop b5. I had a game, I remember, in the 15-minute pool in this line from the black side, and I was surprised how much of an initiative white got after some pretty normal stuff. Like, I think it went like this. And quite quickly, my opponent managed to castle. I think I threw in an a6 move. And there was a point where he could have played e5, and I would have been in big trouble. I think this is the exact position we got. And I would have had pressure on my queen on d8 and my knight on f6. I was black in this position. But instead, he did something generic like rook he1, and I played bishop e7, and I was fine. So white does get a development lead. Black has to know what they're doing to equalize in this line. Can you play a dragon? Probably not. I'm not a big dragon expert, Ernest. Okay, let's get back in there. 3 minute game. John, where's your plant? They're right over here on my shelf. Yeah. Planty McPlant face. And Elohim. Yeah, Tony makes a good point that if you play queen takes d4 in the following variation, you're going to quickly wind up in a bad position. Yeah, so don't play the queen takes d4 line against knight c6 on move 2. Bad idea. Hey, Santiago. Good Scandi line for white, asks Sumat. He wants to know what to do. Well, a line that I've been plugging recently is knight f3 on move 3. I think this is an underrated move. So keeping the c and the d pawns flexible and hoping to push d4 and c4 combined. All right, we've got a rematch with Batman King. Let's play our usual c6 followed by d5. Let's see if he wants to gambit a pawn. Usually they do, knight f3. I'm going to take that pawn. But the thing is, I don't like to hang on to this pawn. You can't really do that for too long in this line. So I'm going to play it in the standard way. They usually go queen c2 now. And we just get a trade. And put the bishop on e6. I like this line with the inclusion of a4, a5 for black. I do feel that that favors black somehow slightly. Let's go here. Then maybe h6. Yeah, I think this is smart. Maybe looking for a g5 move in the future. White's queen lacks squares. g5 could be annoying to them. Granted, I cannot castle now, but I think the push is going to scare their queen off, and I think the damage that my king might incur if I do castle after g5 is negligible. I don't think it's going to be significant. Knight d5 first, or... Nah, let's just play g5 right away. They're going to go queen d4. Okay. Let's castle now. We get a swap. Bishop g4 or no. Bishop d5 even is possible. Also knight d5. Knight d5 seems like the most normal. Bishop g4, h3, bishop takes f3, bishop takes f3. Knight d5 is one line I'm looking at. It's a little bit lame, though. Okay, let's do knight d5 right away. Took a while to play a natural move there, but it's probably fine. So I want to get my knight to b4 eventually. It's a great square for it. Okay, we're going to go f6. He's probably going to play knight d4 now. And then I'm thinking bishop g4, just to annoy him. We're not threatening the pawn on e2, but the fact that his knight might have to remain guarding that pawn is going to irritate him a little bit. Ah, clever reply. Okay, so let's do this. Just repeating the position once to see what he does. If bishop f3, am I going to repeat again? Or bishop back to d7? I think bishop d7 might be a better move. Let's do this. Not because I want to draw, necessarily. I'm worried that if bishop h3, he's just going to move his rook somewhere. And I might regret having my bishop in on h3. Okay, how about now knight b4? This looks like as good a time as any to play it. And he's going to get his knight to c5. Alright, I think I still got to do it, though. If knight b3, I can play b6, at least. That is helpful. Stop his knight from coming into c5. Bishop here? Seems good. Attack his knight, which now has to maneuver. We're going to take that, and then we're going to take here. If he takes... Okay, he's going to do this. If he takes c6, I go here, and I think I have knight a2 after this. Knight a2 with the fork. Unless he has bishop d5 there, that would be quite the move if he has that. I'm still going to do it. Nah, bishop d5 does not work. Bishop d5, I have rook takes c3. So, on the other hand here... Just do this. Attack his bishop. He's got two pieces hanging. So he's got to give up the exchange now. And this is just going to lose a piece. Important that I played b6 in that one. That was a really key move. Okay, let's just do this. We're not going to go after that a4 pawn quite yet. I don't see any reason to. Let's just go here. Try to play rook e5 at some stage. See if we can get him to trade. I know we weaken our structure slightly, but that's not a big deal. Go after his second rank pawns. Now we're going to go after his a-pawn. Knight d3 coming. Attack this pawn. Let's go here. Oh boy. I'm making a mess of this. This is embarrassing. Oh boy, making a mess of this position. Oh man, didn't win that up a piece. How did I let that get away from me? Well, it was a series of decisions. I mean, Rook e5 is probably not necessary at all. I just thought, well, let's get a pair of rooks off the board and my structure doesn't matter. But yeah, it was a series of bad decisions. Once I lose the g pawn, it's still completely winning, but when his pawn comes up to g5 and he's threatening g6, I had a moment of panic. I thought I might lose this. I really did. This is not looking good. I know, right, Ernest? That was bad. I played the opening in this one well. The opening did go pretty well. Time was a big factor too. I knew he was pressuring me on the clock, and I just didn't properly respond to that. And at the very end, his king and his rook are so well positioned, and I'm liable to get flagged too if I'm not careful. Bad game, very bad game. Yeah, I agree, Arslan. Playing okay in the opening and middle game, but not playing my end games too well. This is all fine. Yeah. Maybe got too preoccupied with the A pawn. Probably should have just taken on F2 right here. Many ways I could have improved in this one. Thanks, Flublet. What is Anton saying something? Anton hasn't been very nice to me lately, I'll say. I'm not trying to intentionally ignore him, but he's been throwing some shade at me on Twitter. Okay, one second. Right, let's get back in there. I'm gonna play a couple more games and then probably call it quits. We'll see how I do. Been going for about an hour, coming up on an hour for the stream. Just turned my fan on, so there's even more background noise than usual. Isham, Grandmaster Isham. Let's stick with e4. The Alekhine's defense, okay. I'm gonna play real aggressive. I'm gonna play the four pawns attack. So f4 on move 5. See what Isham has in store against that one. So bishop e3. Now knight c3. Knight f3. I don't actually think this line is that good for white. I was discussing this line with someone fairly recently. It is the principal try for an advantage for white. But I had a game against a guy who cheated, actually, and he knew exactly how to handle this line for black. It was a blitz game. Okay, so let's bring this rook over. F6 challenges the center. Let's take. What to do now? Queen c1, maybe? Seems like a good move. Just uncover the queen on the. Or the rook against the queen on d7. I'm gonna try to gradually target this pawn. That's an interesting move, what he just did there. Okay. Little uncertain about my d5 push, but we'll see what happens. Take, pawn takes is what I'm thinking. It's gonna take, wow. Okay. He wants c4, maybe? He's keen to win that. Yeah, good point. Good point you're making, Isham. And my king will be vulnerable. All right, I'm gonna take here, though. Maybe he just takes on f3. Oh, he's not gonna take on f3. Thought for sure he would do that. Got to move my attack bishop, but also there's queen c5 check to constantly worry about. Overextended. All right, I'm going to do this in the hopes that something decent happens. Ooh, boy. Queen c5 followed by knight g4? Yikes, that could be bad. That's going to be killer if that happens. Hey, floating. Yeah, now he's setting up queen c5. I got to be careful not to just get instantly crushed here. Knight a4, I think necessary to stop queen c5. Maybe just rook a8 now is a good idea for him. Because he can totally just sack on a4. If I play b3 after rook a8, take queen coming to c5, that's over. I want my opponent's position so bad. You ever had that in a game? You're just sitting there thinking, if I was my opponent right now, I would crush me so fast. That's how I feel right now. He's looking for some sort of forced win, but... Alright, queen c3. There's a knight coming to f2 I also have to be concerned about. Let's just play fast. I guess I can throw in d6 at some point if I want to block his queen from coming to c5. Like, if rook a8, probably d6 was there to avoid losing immediately. Well, I gotta stop him from taking on h2. Yeah, queen h3 is not gonna cut it. I mean, g3 seems forced, but I'm worried about bishop e5 after that. I guess I'm just gonna go with it and see what happens. Bishop takes h7, rook takes e5. Do I have to panic yet? Queen d3, maybe? Queen d3. Yeah, I'm gonna try this. Just to try to mix it up. Don't know what else to do in time pressure. Let's give a check. Bring the knight back into civilization. He can check here, though. I know. Guess I'm going to play an endgame with him. If he wants. He may not want it, though. Good move. Good move. Don't know what to play. Position collapsing. Let's keep pushing stuff. Okay. C5 is a good move now. Queen takes d6. Yep, that's over. Nice game by my opponent. This was my fear in this line, that white gets overextended. And I think that's what started to happen after he played bishop g4. The weaknesses in my position are beginning to tell after this. d4 and c4. So if I play e4 more often, I need a better line against the Alekhine's defense. Because there's just too much pressure coming down on d4, c4 in this case. Yes, this is on ICC. I'm not sure what the best line is against the French. That's a matter of opinion, Sarah. I like the Tarrasch variation. Although I haven't been playing it in this stream or anything, but the Tarrasch is a good choice. Trying to obtain a small edge. If you play knight c3 on move 3, you got to be ready for some really sharp stuff in the Winawer variation, bishop b4. So you got to know your theory in that case. Not a big fan of the advanced variation. The exchange is pretty toothless, so I wouldn't recommend that. So knight d2 is a nice compromise. Hey John, what happened to the Master versus Many game? No updates recently. I'm going to make another video or two. I probably need maybe 2 videos to wrap up that series. Once I do that, we'll be all caught up. The game itself is actually over with, although it's been stalling out on chess.com. For some reason, chess.com server is not recognizing a certain result. I don't want to spoil what that result is if you're purely watching the videos and not following the game. What's one thing to do to get dramatically better from an 1100 rating? You have to play a lot, Jamie, and you have to analyze your games. That's two things, but they go hand in hand. Why do you use this site over other sites like LeChess? Well, I play on LeChess as well. I like this site for streaming, though. The layout and the opposition is more conducive to streaming, I think. Okay, I'm going to play one more game and then answer a few questions and then wrap this stream up. Rough session, but hey, that happens sometimes, right? Thanks, Mr. Scottson. The London is fine. I would not recommend it if you're a beginning player, but if you're in the middle rating ranges or a experienced beginner, it can be good to experiment with that. By the way, a little plug for the Finns FAQ. If you click on the description to this video, there's a link to something that Kazi put together. It's called the Finns FAQ. Many of the questions that you guys are asking have been answered in that document. It's really awesome. She even includes timestamps to videos where I talk about certain questions that continually pop up, like what books would you recommend? How do you get better? That sort of thing. So check it out. That's not true, Arab Assassin. I've had some really good sessions lately. All right, we're playing the Scandi against Machine Gun in the final game. I'm going to play the Queen A5 line, even though this line, I think, is going through a crisis right now. There's a borderline refutation out there. I'm not going to say what it is, but there's a borderline refutation to the Queen A5 variation. Okay, what is this about? This is kind of odd, but okay, I'm going to just offer to trade queens against Machine Gun. He's probably going to go B5. No, he doesn't. Okay. Let's go attack that pawn on c2 for now. I think he should have played b5, but maybe not. Maybe he's just going to hold off on that move for a little while. Okay, e5. Yeah, let's play e5. Can't sack on b4. That would be foolish. I'm going to put the bishop on d6. I know they can still play b5, but he seems not willing to do that, unwilling to play that way. Let's go this way. I'm just going to guard that pawn. This guy's really quick. If you can't tell, he's really a fast player. Let's kick this out. Let's bring this knight in. I'm willing to give up the bishop on d6. I think that's okay if that happens. Stick with the rook. Maybe I can play rook c6 and pressure c3/c2. Just take this one. And then we're going to put that rook on c6. Ah, he has bishop g2. So that was perhaps foolish by me to play this way. Knight d5, not getting anywhere. Okay, I'm just going to bring this over. Bishop f5. Okay, let's do that. I'm already down a minute on the clock. I'm going to offer a trade. I was trying to do it in a savvy way, but that didn't happen. Okay, now we're going to try to win one of these pawns, or maybe go knight e3. Knight e3 is a nice move, too. Ooh, knight e3 would be really nice if we could get that in. Yeah, he's playing for complications, as usual. It's a good move, though, what he just did there. And I have to constantly think about how to play against this. Okay, let's be solid. Ah, now my bishop is on the verge of being trapped, though. Okay, I guess I gotta play this way. And then play c6 after he goes h3. This is not so good. Okay, let's do this. hope that this turns out well. Okay. We're going to move our bishop and then play g5. That's the plan. Watch that time, John. Keep telling myself that. Maybe I'll convince myself. Okay, we'll take. Make a move. Okay, so at least I get a passed h pawn. This is helpful. Now he's got to play his bishop back. I'm going to go for something like a5 soon, I think. See what we can gain by doing this. Maybe swing the rook over to a4. Try to go after his a3 pawn. Bring our king up as well. He has to proceed with some care. Let's put the king here. Bring this over. Bring this over. I'm going to go up here, I guess. But now he can play c4. I'm boxing my own rook in. I should not have done that, but okay. I guess we'll go here. This is foolish of me. Still probably fine. Bishop g1. Still a draw, I think, but time is going to be the bigger factor. Yeah, this is a total draw now. I guess I'll offer. Yeah, he offered one. He's a nice guy. Okay, drawn game. Yeah, I had to white knuckle that one at the end. I felt like I was in some danger right around when he played knight d5. Knight d5 was a nice reply to what I was doing, because when he plays that, he stops knight e3, and he also attacks my knight on d4. I missed this move. It's a powerful move. I think I'm just worse here. Let me check, though. Not so bad. Bishop e6 I could have played. Aha, bishop e6, attacking the knight on d5. Yeah, that's better than whatever I did. Knight e6. Knight e6, rook f1, and this knight is precariously placed. Almost trapped. Here I could have got away with taking on h2. Don't know why I didn't think about that either. He perhaps could have flagged me right at the very end. I don't know if I can make 50 moves in, or I guess a little less than 50 moves, 40 moves, let's say, in 13 seconds. I would have been hard-pressed to do that. Nope, I have not read Python Strategy by Petrosian. FR Craft, I do have Twitter. It's in the link below in the description. Are you going to bring back the Play Magnus series? Yes. Hello, David MD. Dennis says, what about bishop g4? And then you can maneuver your bishop onto the long diagonal. Not sure what you mean about that or what moment. Assuming you're talking about this game. I kept thinking he was going to play b5, especially in the opening, but he never did. He just supported the pawn on b4. Opening was okay. I'm satisfied with that. Just didn't play the middle game so well. That's been a theme today. Aside from the Alekhine's defense game that I just played, I think I've been getting good positions out of the opening. Yeah, Tripes, you are late. John, I heard that the f3 line against the Grünfeld is more fashionable for white than the exchange Grünfeld. What are your thoughts? I don't know what the current theory is saying about the f3 line. I assume you're talking about, if I flip the board here, Are you talking about this line, where white plays f3 on move 3? This is something that same-ish players do oftentimes, because if black plays bishop g7 and then you go e4, you're in a King's Indian defense via transposition. So, and if black goes d5, trying to keep it in Grünfeld territory, the idea is to expand with e4, but not allow an exchange of knights on c3. And there's quite a bit of theory in this stuff. I've only played this a couple times. But to your question, no, I'm not sure if it's more popular than the exchange variation. Pedone, I'm okay with the transition to e4 right now. I haven't seriously studied any e4 lines, as you can probably tell, based on some of these games. I'm just trying to play it to get more of a feel for what I used to play. The true test will be when I play it over the board and how I do in my OTB games. Yeah, Tony's right. The Finn's FAQ is truly awesome. Kazi's done a really good job with that. So thank you again to Kazi. You guys should check that out. There's like 50% of the questions you're asking. Okay, that's a little high. Maybe, let's say 10 to 25% of the questions can probably be found in the Finn's FAQ. Any idea on how to play the exchange King's Indian with black? There's a lot of options you have from the black side of the exchange King's Indian. Or did you say same-ish? Same-ish, you said. I don't know why I said exchange. So this is weird looking at this from the black side. I never play this way. So after castles, let's just take this main position. White can play bishop e3 or knight g2, bishop e3 being the main move. I think c5 is always going to be the main line, c5 offering a pawn, but you do get a lot of compensation if white grabs this pawn. But a line that's pretty easy to play is knight c6, the piano variation. And then after knight g2, you go a6, queen d2, rook b8, and you try for b5, expanding on the queen side. So this line's okay if you're looking for a decent weapon. I don't think playing for e5 is very good against the same-ish. I know it's definitely not good in the knight g2 variation. I think against bishop e3, it's even considered suboptimal. So I would shy away from that. And a lot of the King's Indian lines you do play for e5, but against the same-ish, you should try to keep this diagonal more open. So I'd recommend knight c6 in a nutshell. What's your opinion on DGT boards? It seems to me that professional chess broadcasting has an embarrassing tech problem, considering it's 2010. They do their job, the DGTs. I don't have a strong opinion on them one way or the other, but that technology has been around for a while. For those who don't know, a DGT board is, looks just like a normal board, but it's electronic. So the moves, once they're played on the board, there's some sort of sensor system, and it can relay the moves, tell you what's been played on the board. So that's how a lot of major events get broadcast these days. They're playing on DGT boards or similar technology. I think the cost is pretty prohibitive for a lot of people, because I think a DGT board runs at least $300-$400. It'd be nice if they were in even more tournaments, but I think only the big budget tournaments can afford them, or if chess clubs have them and loan them out to be used in the tournament. That's often how they're utilized. Tony says, rip Goran Vojinovic. Is that true? Wow, that's very sad if so. He died? So Goran Vojinovic, I believe that's a player from Ohio, right? An international master? I don't want to say something that isn't true, but I trust Tony. Semen, I might play one more game. We'll see. To wrap up this stream. Oh, wow. Yeah, rest in peace to Goran Vojinovic. Pretty strong IM from Ohio. I think he was a chess teacher. I had never met him. Don't know him personally, but I do know he had a big influence in that area. So I hadn't heard that. Very sad. John, what kind of mouse, keyboard, slash computer do you use? I have an Asus desktop that I've had for the past 2 years. I have a noiseless gaming mouse that I don't even know what company it is. It doesn't even say on the mouse. I'm probably overdue for getting a new mouse. My keyboard is, it's one of these wireless keyboards. Who makes this? The model number is K800. It's a Logitech. It's a Logitech wireless keyboard. Works very well. What do you guys think? One more game? Should I do it? We've had a rough go of it today. I've been trying my best, but things have not been turning out well for me. One more game and then shut this baby down? Yep, Ricardo, I will. I will continue the chess fundamentals series. Oh, Nick, did you ask about the Nimzowitsch Sicilian? I missed that. Nick is a big practitioner of the Nimzowitsch Sicilian, which is e4, c5, knight f3, knight f6. I think an underestimated line. It's not so bad, and Nick can tell you all about it. One more game. Let's do it. I'm going to need your fire emojis in there. I'm going to need the fire, guys. The backs of Team Scandi are going to have to bear this weight that I've put you under today, this strain of my bad play. So get those fire emojis ready. All right, let's do this. We're sticking with e4 if it's a white game. If black, of course, we'll wait and see what happens. e3 on move one. We're not playing e3 on move one. Play something offbeat, says Christopher. Thank you, Anton, for the fire emojis. You know I love you, Anton, even though I've been giving you a hard time. All right, JBJ is going to be the final opponent. 22-21. Boy, my rating has taken a beating today. Look at that, 24-05. All right, I'm going to play a slightly offbeat line if he goes g6. Ah, they play e5, the bummer variation. Okay, let's do what we did against Fire Tiger. This line has been popular lately, huh? Lots of people playing this way. Okay, so let's play h3 just as we did before. And put the bishop on e3. Nothing unusual yet. I guess I'll play this way too. So we got to be aware of that knight to c5 idea. Okay, I think this is the exact position we had last time. Okay, what's he going for? Knight c4? Let's put a stop to that. Maybe at some point I can take, and then that knight on b6 will be a target. So I'm trying to keep that knight out of play. Let's go f5. He can take here, though, and get some squares, but maybe I can live with this. This should be all right. I can probably survive this mini crisis. I always have f6, but I'm going to leave the tension because it seems favorable to do so. Let's double up our rooks, huh? Double them up on the f-file. Really? Take. Okay. Well, that's interesting. I don't know about that move. Now f6 seems powerful if I ever get to play that. And he might have to play f6 himself. He does. That looks super ugly, doesn't it? Kind of cringing at the setup black currently has, but it's going to be tough to get through. I could take and then win d6, but is it worth it to go through that pain just for a measly pawn? I don't think so. Knight e4 seems correct. Just increasing the pressure. Let's do that. Let's not fall in love with our position to the extent that we forget about the clock. So I've got my knight into c5. Debatable what it's accomplishing there, but it does eye the e6 square. I want to go knight e6, but... you know what? Let's do it. Okay, so if he takes twice, I'm going to play knight f4. And if bishop h6, I can take on e6. That's important, hitting the queen. So I'm hoping to get knight h5 in after this. That's my whole plan right now. Yeah, now this move. Go after that pawn. And he's maneuvering. Maneuvering as best he can. Let's keep the pressure. Go attack f6. Not going to make any decision yet about whether we're going to take g7 or take f6. we'll leave that open to debate. Oh man, I'm seeing fun stuff. Okay, let's go G4, first of all. Let's go rook F5, increase the pressure maybe. Queen F2 is an idea now. So we're down a pawn, but we've got a lot of compensation. Two bishops, his structure is really weak. Can snipe back a pawn here. I think I'm going to do that. This looks good. Let's bring it back this way. Maybe put the bishop on G3. D5 is quite loose. He has to defend that. Let's go here. And if D3, I'll probably play C4 and try to bully my bishop into D5. Stop him from playing C4. Yeah, I'm liking this. He's got a lot of stuff on dark squares, so his light squares should be weak. Gotta watch that time again. Okay, let's give it check. Go here, maybe G5 coming up. Boy, G5 would be devastating if I get a chance to play that move. I'm gonna go for it. Take. This move I missed. Does that work, though? Take E5? No, that doesn't quite work. I think I can do this. I'm gonna play this way. I wonder if he can check on E2, though. This is gonna get weird in a second. Okay, because now I was thinking do this. Ugh, complicated position. Let's see if he takes. Queen back two, okay. Ah, he can just do that. It's awkward. But I think this is okay, right? Take. 19 seconds left, though. Threatening check, followed by bishop e5. Check. Let's play bishop f4. Well, he's just barely wriggling free. But he is wriggling. Oh, man. Oh, man. Oh, I can't stop him from promoting. Unbelievable. Oh, the dream is dead. Let's take. I don't know what else to do. Oh. Oh, man. I went down in flames. I went down in flames. Just not my day, not my stream, guys. This was hard to figure out what to do here. I had to be careful in this position. I think if I play king g2, he can play queen takes f6, g takes f6, rook takes g3. That's what I was trying to avoid. Bummer. I thought I was playing a good game. I like this line for white against the Pirates. So I'll continue playing it probably. But yeah, this position, right around the time I got g5 in, this looked really good. Did I just miss something straightforward here? Bishop takes c6? Nah, never mind. But this position looks excellent for white. The two bishops, wonderfully placed. The only thing he really has going for him is knight d4 coming. But I didn't manage to find a solution to that problem. Ah, knight takes g7 is good here. Knight takes g7, rook takes g7, then bishop takes c6. And if he takes with the queen, then bishop takes e5 is the idea with that hanging rook on f8. Oh, it was plus 9. bishop takes e5 right here. I don't have to do anything with my attacked rook. Just take on e5, and then yeah, if he takes back with the pawn, we go take on f8. This made the position a lot more complicated. Even here, I should be winning somehow, right? Rook g8 is winning. And then if king f6 or king h6, we have either bishop f4 or bishop h4. Yeah, and at the very end, I had no time left. Also, stopping the pawn is proving tricky. Let's take a look at the final standings. I had a lot of draws this session. Not many wins. Did I only win one game this session? That's terrible. I only won one game. I lost four. So I was one win, four losses, and however many draws that is, four draws? Yeah, not good at all. I blew some clearly winning positions. This game against Fire Tiger, I was up an entire rook in the time scramble, didn't win. Game against Deep Strategy, yeah, he just beat me. Batman King, two draws, got kind of lucky in the first one. Second one, I was up a piece and failed to win in the end game. Isham beat me fair and square in a nice game in the Alekhines. This game, kind of fortunate to get a draw on that one. And probably should have won that last game. But hey, hindsight's 20/20. These things happen in chess, as I always say. Definitely one of my worst streams, though. I feel like going and lighting some fireworks now. James, I have to run. But I wish everyone a very happy evening or day, wherever or whatever the time may be in your neck of the woods. Yes, as Ernest says, you win some, you lose some. You gotta have a short memory. That's right. I give myself a 3 or 4 out of 10 the way I played today. Again, the openings, middle games were good. End games left much to be desired. Anyways, thank you all for tuning in. It was fun. And I will be back again with some more streams, some more videos. All right, guys, talk to you later. Bye.